Welcome to another episode of FemgineerTV, brought to you by Pivotal Tracker. I'm your host, Pornima Vijay Shankar, the founder of Femgineer. In this show, I invite innovators in tech, and together we debunk myths and misconceptions related to building tech products and companies. One of the most heated topics today is the lack of women and minorities represented in tech, from entry level to the C-suite to the boardroom. While we all know this is already a problem, in today's episode, we're going to be talking about some of the solutions and showing how there are companies and organizations enacting these solutions. And to help us out, I've invited Samantha Walravens, who is the co-author of the latest book, Geek Girl Rising, Inside the Sisterhood Shaking Up Tech. Thanks so much for joining us today, Samantha.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah, it's wonderful. Let's start by talking about why you and your co-author, Heather Cabot, decided to write this book.
Yeah, the inspiration for this book was a conversation I had about 3 years ago with a friend of mine who's been in Silicon Valley for 20 years. She's a woman. She's a VP of sales and business development, and she's worked at a number of tech startups. And we were having coffee, and she said, Sam, I cannot tell you what just happened. My performance review was last week, and my manager commented on what I was wearing, the color of my dresses, the jewelry I wore, and he told me that I was too aggressive and too bossy and I needed to tone it down a bit. Meanwhile, she is the head of sales and she was rocking her number out of the park. So she said, Sam, you've got to write something. She knew I was a journalist. She said, you got to write something and you have to talk about this kind of discrimination and this kind of sexism in Silicon Valley. Mind you, this is before the Newsweek article came out, what does Silicon Valley really think of women? This is sort of, people were discussing women in technology, but it really was not top of mind.
Sure.
So I started doing a little digging and researching and interviewing women. And what I found was, yes, there's sexism, there's harassment, there's discrimination, there's unconscious bias. It's there. It's a problem. We need to talk about it and deal with it. But there was another narrative, another discussion that wasn't being told, which was these women wanted to talk about the companies they were building, the technologies they were creating, the women who were supporting them and helping them along the way in their careers. There was this whole other narrative that was missing from the conversation that was happening in the national news media about sexism in Silicon Valley. And I thought, you know, we have to discuss this. So Heather Cabot, who's my co-author, was in New York. I'm in San Francisco. We talked and she said, Sam, I've been researching this topic. It was kind of coincidence. It was like one of those weird moments of like weird fate. And she said, I've been researching this topic. Let's work together. So we put our heads together and we just started digging in to the topic. And, you know, it's been 3 years now and finally the book is coming out.
So one thing I experienced early on in my career and it keeps me motivated is the women who inspired me. So early on when I was a college student in engineering school, I had a professor and she had twins and she was doing her research and she was teaching and she was leading the department. And I thought, well, if she could do it, you know, I could do it. And as I was reading the book, I noticed the theme of the sisterhood kind of coming up again and again. Tell us how you kind of discovered this theme as you started writing or as you started doing your research.
Of course, yeah. Well, I too had a mentor back in my Silicon Valley days. I worked for a software startup during the dot-com boom and from 1998 till about 2003. Mm-hmm. So I saw the dot-com boom and the bust happen. I was living through it. Our company went public. Stock went to 130 and then went down to 2. So I lived and breathed the dot-com boom and bust. Mm-hmm. My manager, boss at that point was Carol Carpenter, who has since gone on to she was the CEO of as a CMO of ClearSlide and the CEO of Elastic Box. So mm-hmm. She's a, you know, prominent woman in Silicon Valley. And she really pulled me up. She really, when I was lacking confidence and I thought, you know, I can't do this. I just had a baby, my first baby. We were going public. And I thought, I can't do this. This is crazy. We're working 24/7 and I have a newborn at home. And she was the one who said, Sam, you can do it. You can do it. And having that kind of mentorship and that kind of, mm-hmm. you know, that woman who was going through it herself, pulling me up, really encouraged me. So as we were researching the book, we started noticing these pockets around the startup universe of women who were supporting each other, investing in each mm-hmm. other, encouraging each other in their careers, and inspiring the next generation of girls and young women to pursue technology and continue their careers in technology.
Yeah, that's great. I think you're absolutely right. That is a narrative that's missing from the media, and more women need to know that that's out there as well, so that they don't feel like all there is what the media portrays. Now, the first place that you write about change happening is at the primary school up to the high school level. So walk us through what that looks like.
Yeah, well, fortunately, before Obama left office, he did create an initiative, a $4 billion initiative called Computer Science for All, that is encouraging and putting funds towards creating computer science curriculum in schools throughout the country. Mm-hmm. I was so excited to read about Rahm Emanuel in Chicago, in the Chicago Public Schools. Now, computer science is a requirement for all high schools in Chicago. So I think we're going to see more of that. When you look at the numbers, though, we still have a long way to go. Sure. It's 25% of high schools in the U.S. offer computer science, and I think it's like 22% of girls, mm-hmm. of students taking the computer science AP exam are girls. So we still have a long way to go. What we noticed, though, sort of this grassroots movement of mm-hmm. women who are encouraging the younger generations to start building, to start creating, to start coding. For example, we start our book with talking about Debbie Sterling, who's the founder and the CEO of Goldie Blocks. And mm-hmm. she's got this great, I have two little girls.
Yep.
We have it at home. It's a great toy that encourages girls to build. And there's a really fun, positive role model, Goldie,
mm-hmm.
who builds a spinning machine. And she has all these sorts of engineering. You wouldn't even know it's engineering. It's really just building Ferris wheels and building merry-go-rounds and all these fun things, along with the story talking about Goldie and her friends and how she's building these different fun, games and amusement park rides.
Mm-hmm.
So we have that in our household. Those are the kinds of things that women are doing to try to inspire the next generation. There's a woman in our book who started a company called VidCode, which she's actually working with the public schools mm-hmm. to get them to use video to teach girls how to code. So, you know, if you have kids, you know that they're on video, they're on YouTube, and they're really tech savvy.
Mm-hmm.
And they can, you know, I have four kids, they can get around YouTube and then iMovie, they're all over it. So this tool is used in the public schools to teach coding using videos to make it fun.
Mm-hmm. That's great. Yeah, it's good to see these grassroots efforts, so that even if there is kind of a gap in terms of change for the public schools or school system in general, there's ways in which parents and teachers can sort of supplement that. So the next place where a lot of women and minorities drop off is at the college level.
Mm-hmm.
Tell us who's working on changing that.
Well, we had the most amazing experience at Grace Hopper mm-hmm. in 2015. I believe you were there.
Yeah.
And Heather and I, my co-author and I went, and just to see, I think it was 12,000 women there in computing. And it is a true celebration. Mm-hmm. And to see the enthusiasm and the excitement and the bonding between these young women, it was so encouraging. But when you look at specific colleges, there's a lot being done to encourage more women to pursue technology and computer science. I met with Maria Klawe, who's mm-hmm. the president of Harvey Mudd, and wow, what a firecracker she is. She skateboards around campus. She's just a really fun, wonderful woman. And she implemented a program along with her colleagues a few years ago, where there are two tracks for computer science. So mm-hmm. as a freshman, you can take the gold track or the black track. The gold track is for students who have not had any computer science experience in high school. The black track is for students who have some experience.
Mm-hmm.
So by doing this, the students who have not had experience don't feel so
imposter.
Yeah. Like they don't lack the confidence because no one else has had this experience.
Right.
So they get through this year. And I spoke to a couple of the students who have taken these classes, and they say by the end of the year, everyone's pretty much at the same level.
Oh, that's great.
So Maria Klawe and her team has tripled the number of women graduating with computer science degrees at Harvey Mudd in the past 10 years.
Nice.
And the number is, I hate to throw out all these numbers because they get a little mind-boggling at times, but 55% of the computer science graduates at Harvey Mudd are now women.
That's great.
Yeah.
Yeah. So a nice change to
amazing.
The numbers go up.
Yeah. There's also Stanford. Can I talk to
you?
Okay. Another example of what's going on to encourage women to pursue computer science is Stanford University of course, a top institution, sure. but they have a women in tech group called She++, which was started, started by Aina Agarwal, and who was not even a computer science major, by the way, but she started this group to encourage women. And I was at, they had a gala, they have a gala every year, which gathers all the women in technology, not just Stanford, but what they do is they go out into the communities and they take on high school students in different communities around the country, and they support these young high school girls to start programs in their communities. For example, I live up in Marin County, and there's a girl who started a robotics, after-school robotics program in Marin City, which is an underserved community in Marin County, and she runs this after-school program in Marin City. So all of these girls around the country who are starting these programs through She++ gather together for this gala, and I am telling you, if you could be there to see these college women, these high school girls who came, they were dressed to the nines. They were glamorous. I mean, talk about debunking the myths and the breaking the stereotypes of what a woman in tech looks like. I mean, we could have been at an LA nightclub. Not to sound like that, but just to say, I mean, they were just so beautiful and wonderful and smart and excited to talk about their programs, and they were so excited to be in technology. And again, this is why Heather and I said, this is a story that no one sees.
Right.
You don't see this kind of enthusiasm around technology. You see, oh, it's so hard, the numbers are dropping, it's all doom and gloom.
Yeah.
And so we really wanted to tell that other story.
Okay, that brings us back to industry. And I know there's a lot going on at the corporate level as well as startups. I'm, of course, partial to startups. So let's start there and talk about how the ecosystem is changing for women and minorities.
Mm-hmm. There's a lot of momentum behind supporting female founders. Mm-hmm. For example, there are accelerator programs like the Women's Startup Lab, which is down here in Menlo Park. There's Merge Lane, which is in Colorado. There's the Refinery in Connecticut. These programs focus on female founders and really giving them the tools and the skills they need to grow their company into a venture fundable company. Yeah. And they give them the tools to learn how to pitch venture capitalists. And we all know the venture capital world is very male dominated.
Yeah, it is. It is a challenge. I know I've certainly had my fair share of fun doing the fundraising. Mm-hmm. So there's a very common problem around women and minorities getting up and pitching their businesses to VCs, either, you know, male VCs not getting their idea, or they don't think it's a big enough market, or there's a lot of unconscious bias around it. So how are women getting the training to kind of get over all of that?
Well, I mean, you've started a company, so you know what it's like. It's the women, the founders that we've met, that I've met in my journey with this book, are so passionate about their idea. But you could have an idea, and it's not going to go anywhere. You have to have, you know, the product market fit. You have to test the idea. You have to build your team out. And so these programs are really teaching women what they need to do to get to that level to actually pitch to investors. But when you look at the numbers, you know, that I think it's 10% of the venture funding globally goes to female founders. It's still a really small percentage. So we've also noticed that there's women who are angels.
Yeah.
So angel investors who fund companies at the early stages. For example, Joanne Wilson, a.k.a. Gotham Gal, who's a tremendous woman in New York City, who has invested in a number of really great companies, Karen Mayo, Nestio, Shanna Tellerman at Motsy. She finds these women who have ideas that are big, that are scalable, and she nurtures them. And she's like the fairy godmother to these women. And there are other women that we talk about in our book. You have to read the book to learn about all of them. But there are women who really take these female founders under their wing and support them on their journey.
I think it's great that there's women like Joanne Wilson out there. Do you have a sense of like how many women companies she's invested in?
Joanne Wilson has invested in around 100 companies.
Yeah, that's fantastic.
Yeah, and they're doing fantastic. You know, one of them, Shanna Tellerman, started a company, Modsy, which is an immersive 3D environment for home decor and home design. And she told us that she created this project called the Pinnacle Project. It was in Park City, Utah, and it was like a Wednesday through a Sunday, I think. And she invited Joanne and Susan Lai and a bunch of angel investors, as well as a number of female founders, to come gather, network, ski, and have fun. And she said it was funny because all the women we're thinking, well, we should be home. We should be, you know, we should be working. We should be with the kids. We have so much to do. And she said she had to tell and remind people that this is what the guys do, right? Yeah. They have the boys club. They play golf. And it's all about business. Whereas, you know, women don't have that sense of let's go off and ski and play golf and that kind of networking. And so it was an example of this Pinnacle project, which is going to happen recurring every year of, okay, women, we can get together, have fun together, network, introduce each other to investors and influencers and have fun while we're doing it. It's okay.
Yeah, that's fantastic. And I think another thing you had mentioned is Pipeline Ventures, right? Or Pipeline Angels?
Pipeline Angels, yes, yeah. Yes. So Natalia Oberti Noguera is a force of nature, and she started this angel investing group for women. Mm-hmm. And I went through it, and Heather went through it. I did it in San Francisco. Heather did it in New York. And basically, it's a boot camp or a training program for women who are accredited investors to learn how to invest in female and minority-led companies. Mm-hmm. So walked us through the process of how do you set a valuation on a company, what do you look for in a startup that you're investing in, you know, what kind of traits do you want to look for in the team, what's going to make this a good investment. So it trains women to invest as angels, and then you actually make an investment at the end. So we made an investment in a great startup, which I believe is still hush-hush under the radar at this point, but we made a great investment, and we're following the course of these early-stage female founders, and it's really her goal is to change the face of angel investing, to increase the amount of money going towards early-stage female founders.
So as you were doing research for your book, and when I was reading it, I noticed that there were some astonishing findings, like only 11 companies that were founded by African-American women had received funding over $1 million. So walk us through who's working to change this.
Well, that number has actually increased.
Good.
It's now 13 companies that have received more than $1 million. But the numbers are still really low. One woman who is really on top of this problem is Catherine Finney, who is the founder of Digital Undivided, which is an organization that whose main purpose is to increase the number of women minorities in the tech world, Latina women and Black women founders. Mm-hmm. And she just recently launched an accelerator in Atlanta, Georgia, called the Big Innovation Center. Uh-huh. And they're just starting, I think it's their first cohort is gathering this year to to help skill up and prepare these minority founders to raise money.
So let's switch gears and talk about corporations. We previously had Lisen Stromberg on the show talking about the changes that were happening for parents. What have you seen?
Yeah, well, what we've noticed is that Silicon Valley is growing up. Mm-hmm. You know, they're trading in their ping pong tables and foosball tables for nursing rooms.
Okay.
Which is inspiring to see. When I started out, I was had my Medela pump and style in a cold bathroom out in the courtyard of our startup. So it wasn't pretty. But we spent a day at Eventbrite not too long ago, and Julia Hartz, who's now the CEO of Eventbrite, is very focused on women, developing women in leadership positions, and allowing for work-life balance. Mm-hmm. And I say the word work-life balance, that term, like
it's
loaded. But what she's trying to do with that company is focus on the whole person, not just the employee self. So, for example, they have a program called Take the Time You Need. So if you need time to care for a child or to care for an adult, you can work from home. Mm-hmm. You can take time off. So she's really putting trust in her employees and telling her employees, you can do what you need to do so you can live a life and you can be an employee. And she also tells the women who are having babies at her company, she says, you know what, if you can get through these, you know, the first 6 to 9 months, it gets a lot easier, because a lot of women, when they have their babies early on, they think, I can't leave this poor creature alone with a daycare or with a babysitter. And she says, if you can just get through that, and she's got two little girls herself, if you can just get through that time, stick with it, come back, and we will support you while you're doing it, which is fantastic.
You also showcased companies like Power to Fly. Walk us through what Power to Fly is.
Yeah, Power to Fly was started by Milena Berry and Catherine Zelensky. Catherine actually wrote an article apologizing to all the mothers out there. Before she had children, she was a little bit judgmental of mothers and taking time off and having to leave work early. And then she had her first baby and she thought, oh my gosh, this is really hard. So she and Melina got together and started this company, Power to Fly, which is connects women with remote and flexible job positions so they can actually care for their family and pursue careers in technology. The great thing about technology is that it can be done remotely, especially if you're in coding. You don't have to be in an office 24/7. So Power to Fly works on that. Another great program is Tina Lee started a program called Mother Coders, and she's based in San Francisco. Fabulous woman. Her program retrains mothers in tech skills so they can go off and they can, you know, they've taken time off or they have, you know, a background in some other field. They can skill up in technology and go out and get the tremendous amount of jobs that are available in technology so they can get back to work.
Well, that brings us to the boardroom. So walk us through what changes are happening there.
The number of women holding board seats in our country is still very, very low. I think the number is 18% of board seats at Fortune 500 companies are held by women. So we still have a long way to go. One real pioneer in this area is a woman. Her name is Sukhinder Singh Cassidy. She's fabulous. She is the CEO and founder of a company called Joyous, a tech company. And she, a few years ago, penned an article called Tech Women Choose Possibility. And she really wanted to profile the women in Silicon Valley, in the startup world, who are doing great things and founding great companies. There was a lot of positive response to that article. And so she created an organization called hashtag Choose Possibility. Part of that organization is a group called, or an initiative called The Board List. And basically it's a matchmaking tool that matches qualified board-ready women with startup tech companies looking to fill board seats with women. So she made that happen, and they placed three women on the boards the first year, which seems like it's very low. But what they're doing is they're connecting the VCs and the startup companies with these women, and a lot more placements have been made, not directly through the platform, but just through the connections that have been made on this platform.
Got it. Okay, great. So it's good to know that there is some change happening at the board level as well. Well, thank you so much for joining us today, Samantha. I know our viewers out there are going to enjoy reading your book, Geek Girl Rising. And for our viewers who are women, minority, and allies, is there anything else you would like to share with them in terms of resources?
Yeah, I would love just to invite everybody to come to our website. We have a gazillion resources on how you can join the digital revolution and just take a peek.
Thanks for tuning in today, and special thanks to our sponsor, Pivotal Tracker, for their help in producing this episode of Femgineer TV. If you've enjoyed this episode, then please be sure to share it with your friends, your teammates, your boss, and everyone so that they get to benefit from all the great resources. And subscribe to our channel to receive the next episode. Ciao for now.
This episode of FemgineerTV is brought to you by Pivotal Tracker. Build better software faster.